Penguin Random House Audio presents The First World War by John Keegan. Read for you by James Langton. 1. A European Tragedy. The First World War was a tragic and unnecessary conflict. Unnecessary because the train of events that led to its outbreak might have been broken at any point. During the 5 weeks of crisis that preceded the first clash of arms, had prudence or common goodwill found a voice. Tragic because the consequences of the first clash ended the lives of 10 million human beings, tortured the emotional lives of millions more, destroyed the benevolent and optimistic culture of the European continent, and left, when the guns at last fell silent 4 years later, a legacy of political rancor and racial hatred so intense that no explanation of the causes of the Second World War can stand without reference to those roots. The Second World War, 5 times more destructive of human life and incalculably more costly in material terms, was the direct outcome of the first. On 18 September 1922, Adolf Hitler, the demobilized front fighter, threw down a challenge to defeated Germany that he would realize 17 years later. It cannot be that 2 million Germans should have fallen in vain. No, we do not pardon. We demand vengeance. The monuments to the vengeance he took stand throughout the continent he devastated, in the reconstructed centers of his own German cities, flattened by the strategic bombing campaign that he provoked, and of those, Leningrad, Stalingrad, Warsaw, Rotterdam, London, that he himself laid waste. The derelict fortifications of the Atlantic Wall, built in the vain hope of holding his enemies at bay, are monuments to his desire for vengeance. So too are the decaying hutments of Auschwitz, and the remnants of the obliterated extermination camps at Sobibor, Belzec, and Treblinka. A child's shoe in the Polish dust, a scrap of rusting barbed wire, a residue of pulverized bone near the spot where the gas chambers worked, these are as much relics of the First as of the Second World War. They have their antecedents in the scraps of barbed wire that litter the fields where the trenches ran, filling the French air with the smell of rust on a damp morning, in the mildewed military leather a visitor finds under a hedgerow, in the verdigrised brass of a badge or button, corroded clips of ammunition and pockmarked shards of shell. They have their antecedents also in the anonymous remains, still upturned today by farmers ploughing the blood-soaked soil of the Somme. I stop work at once. I have a great respect for your English dead. Just as the barely viewable film of bodies being heaped into the mass graves at Belsen in 1945 has its antecedents in the blurred footage of French soldiers stacking the cored wood of their dead comrades after the Second Battle of Champagne in 1915. The First World War inaugurated the manufacture of mass death that the Second brought to a pitiless consummation. There are more ceremonial monuments. Few French and British communities lack a memorial to the dead of the Second World War. There is one in my West Country village, a list of names carved at the foot of the funerary crucifix that stands at the crossroads. It is, however, an addition and an afterthought. The cross itself was raised to commemorate the young men who did not return from the First World War, and their number is twice that of those killed in the Second. From a population of 200 in 1914, W. Gray, A. Lapham, W. Newton, A. Norris, C. Penn, L. Penn, and W. J. White, perhaps 1 in 4 of the village's men of military age, did not come back from the front. Theirs are names found in the church registers that go back to the 16th century. They survive in the village today. It is not difficult to see from the evidence that the Great War brought heartbreak on a scale never known since the settlement was established by the Anglo-Saxons before the Norman conquest, and thankfully has not been known since. The memorial cross is, the church apart, the only public monument the village possesses. It has its counterpart in every neighbouring village, in the county's towns, where the names multiply many times, and in the cathedral of the diocese at Salisbury. It has its counterpart, too, in every cathedral in France, in each of which will be seen a tablet bearing the inscription, "To the glory of God and in memory of 1 million men of the British Empire who died in the Great War, and of whom the greater number rest in France." Nearby, certainly, will stand a memorial to the locality's own dead, itself replicated in every surrounding town and village. France lost nearly 2 million in the Great War, 2 out of every 9 men who marched away. They are often symbolized by the statue of a poilu, defiant in horizon blue, levelling a bayonet eastward at the German frontier. The list of names on the plinth is heartrendingly long, all the more heartrending because repetition of the same name testifies to more than one death, often several in the same family. There are similar lists to be seen graven in stone in the towns and cities of most combatant nations of the Great War. Particularly poignant, I find, is the restrained classicism of the memorial to the cavalry division of the Veneto that stands beside the Cathedral of Murano in the Lagoon of Venice, bearing row after row of names of young men from the lowlands of the River Po who died in the harsh uplands of the Julian Alps. I am touched by the same emotion in the churches of Vienna, where severe stone tablets recall the sacrifice of historic Habsburg regiments, now almost forgotten to history. The Germans, who cannot decently mourn their 4 million dead of the Second World War, compromised as the Wehrmacht was by the atrocities of the Nazi state, found a materially, if not morally equivalent, difficulty in arranging an appropriately symbolic expression of grief for their fallen of the first, since so many lay on foreign soil. The battlefields of the East were closed to them by the Bolshevik Revolution, those of the West made at best grudgingly accessible for the retrieval and reburial of bodies. The French and the Belgians found little room in their hearts or in the national soil for the creation of German war cemeteries, while the British were accorded a sepulture perpetuelle for their places of burial, which ramified during the 1920s into an archipelago of gardened graveyards along the line of the Western Front, breathtaking in their beauty, the Germans were obliged to excavate mass graves in obscure locations to contain the remains of their casualties. Only in East Prussia, on the site of the Tannenberg epic, did they succeed in creating a mausoleum of triumphal monumentality for the fallen. At home, far from the fronts where their young men had died, they gave form to the sorrow in church and cathedral monuments that take their inspiration chiefly from the austerity of high Gothic art, often using the image of Grunewald's crucifixion or Holbein's Christ in the tomb as their theme. The Christ of Grunewald and Holbein is a body that has bled, suffered, and died, untended in its final agony by relative or friend. The image was appropriate to the symbolization of the Great War's common soldier, for over half of those who died in the West, perhaps more in the East, were lost as corpses in the wilderness of the battlefield. So numerous were those missing bodies that, in the war's immediate aftermath, it was proposed, first by an Anglican clergyman who had served as a wartime chaplain, that the most fitting of all the memorials to the war dead would be a disinterment and reburial of one of those unidentified in a place of honour. A body was chosen, brought to Westminster Abbey, and placed at the entrance under a tablet bearing the inscription, "They buried him among the kings because he had done good toward God and toward his house." On the same day, the second anniversary of the armistice of 11th November 1918, a French unknown soldier was buried under the Arc de Triomphe in Paris, and unknown soldiers were later reburied in many of the victor nations' capitals. When the defeated Germans attempted to create a national memorial to their dead in 1924, however, the unveiling broke down into a welter of political protest. The speech, made by President Ebert, who had lost 2 sons, was heard out. The 2 minutes of silence that was supposed to follow was interrupted by the shouting of pro-war and anti-war slogans, which precipitated a riot that lasted all day. The agony of a lost war continued to divide Germany, as it would until the coming of Hitler.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.